was feeling, and the emptiness I tried so hard to hide. Though I laughed, I said my life is fine without you. I was covering up the secret tears I cried. And then one day, someone told me of your mercy. Oh, and the love you showed that day on Calvary. For there you died to purchase my redemption. When you broke sin's power and set my spirit free, I'm amazed that you love me. I'm amazed how you care. Through your precious blood I found pardon, and my sins are washed. They're all washed away. All my sins are washed away. Yes, it's true. There have been days when I have failed you. Lord, you know the many times I've gone astray. Oh, but I've learned your love is stronger than my weakness. And your ear is open every time I pray. For no one else has ever cared for me like you, Lord. And other friends can never be as close to me. For I'm not afraid to face the problems of tomorrow, knowing you are everything I'll ever need. Oh, I'm amazed that you love me. Yes, I'm amazed how you care. Through your precious blood I found pardon. Oh, they're all washed away. All my sins are washed away. I'm amazed that you love me. I'm amazed how you care. Through your precious blood I found pardon. Yes, they're all washed away. All my sins are washed. Oh, they're all washed away. All my sins are washed away.
You will go ahead and find yourself in Psalms 105. You could probably look over Genesis 39 and maybe even Genesis 40. Tonight there'll be numbers of places that we will be, but I do want to read a verse out of Psalms 105 to begin what God has put on my heart. Wednesday night I begin to preach about some things that God had pressed upon me that I have learned within myself. Just as this morning, it's hard for a man to testify and preach about something that he's never experienced. Until you've ever been to a place where you have found yourself to be lost, you don't know how to tell somebody to ever get found. It's the same thing when it comes to salvation as it is the other things, whether it be something that you face, you struggle with, a prayer life, inconsistencies. Without any doubt or any question, a lot of the things, unfortunately, as I said today when Spencer came up and began to testify, I wish all I had to do was dream things for God to teach me things. Y'all with me? Say amen. But it is experience. And I'll try to do my very best and diligence to be able to get through all this tonight, but I hope that it'll be a blessing and a help to you, and maybe even insight as God to begin to deal with my heart. We're going to read in Psalms 105 just to understand the storyline, if you will. Read starting in verse number 16. Notice the Bible as it says this: "Moreover, he called for a famine upon the land. He brake the whole staff of bread. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters, and was laid in iron." He was laid in iron until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. The king sent and loosed him, even the ruler of the people, and let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his substance, to bind his princes and pleasure at his pleasure and teach his senators wisdom. Look back, if you will, to verse number 19. Until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. When you come into this psalm in Psalms 105, if you was to go back and read the first five verses, most psalms almost tiptoe into the very climax of what they're saying. But when you start reading Psalms 105, it is something that begins to explode with praise about the things that God has already done. I mean, it is starting off, it says, "Give thanks, sing it to the Lord, glory to his name, let the heart of them rejoice, seek the Lord and his strength, seek his face, remember his marvelous works." I mean, the psalmist comes out and is almost in a place to where he is hammered down, giving glory to God. And then he begins to unfold why he is so praisefully, if you will, or so humbly praising the Lord, why he is in a position to where now he has given God all the glory. You ever seen people like that when they come to church? Man, they come out, they shoot, they're running wide open. They're like, "Hallelujah, amen, praise God." It's not emotionalism, but it's a relationship that they know they have walked with God. And because of experience, they're not defeated even in the darkest hour of their life. And you wonder, why can they do that? How is it possible? And the reason is because there's been some things that they have learned. This text that we read teaches us, as most of us know, that Joseph went through some testing as he waited for God to give him what he needed for the time that God was going to come and help him. And as he waited, literally he came to a place that he thought, "How am I ever going to get out of this?" When you get back and it talks about those things on his feet and the iron that's there, it's talking about the actual description of when he was in prison. Now stay with me, because you got to understand this. This is a man that they're praising the Lord, but he begins to talk about what he went through and why he waited for God to do something in his life. There was tough times. There were trials. There were emotions. There was adversary or opposition that had come against him. And he had went through these things and he had faced stuff that he never could comprehend. And during this time of his life, as he tried to find victory over the very things that he faced, whatever it may be in your life, "Lord, how much longer do I have to go through this? How much time do I have? God, when will you actually help me? When is my time come for God to use me and do things?" But as we wait, there are trials, there are tests, there is opposition, and we begin to say things such as, "I didn't sign up for this. This ain't what I thought it would be. This ain't fair. I'm God's chosen child. This just is not right." There is times where we begin to have a complex that we don't know what to do. The hurt, the rejection, the abandonment, if you will, it settles into our soul. And the whole time we're wondering, "How can I ever overcome?" And when we come to this place of waiting, it leads to a time of personal growth. Personal growth, because it reveals one of two things: either our pain is what we dwell and what we focus on, or it's God's purpose. So let me make it plain. When the trial comes, in the waiting, as the Bible says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. And it gets to a place where he says, when you wait, that don't mean coward. That don't mean stop. That don't mean turn back. That don't mean second guess. That don't mean ask God why. The waiting process is a continual process to seek the Lord, serve the Lord, have the right perspective, and go on for the glory of God. But we come to this place to where it reveals the things of whether we focus on our pain or the purpose of God. Key word that a lot of us will never admit to, but we talk a lot about, that's where the thought of being a victim begins to settle in. The definition of a victim, if you will, by Webster's Dictionary said someone that is cheated, fooled, or hurt by somebody else. A victim is somebody that has come to a place that somebody that has been harmed by an unpleasant event, something that has happened in their life that they did not understand, that has reached down and gripped them and changed their life and begin to change things the way they knew it. And just as Timothy was speaking about the trials and tribulation, it's an unpleasant event that you think, when is my time to come to get out of this? And you find yourself having a victim mentality. Victim is also defined as someone that is acted on or usually adversarially affected by a force or by an agent. In other words, an individual that has a group of people or an individual that has come upon you, that has affected you, that has been in an evil manner, that has not been appropriate, something that is not right. It seems to be unjust, and now you're at a place to where you feel like you have done wrong, and we come to this thing in our mind where we feel like we are a victim. So it goes back to the question, how do we get back to the place of Joseph where we know that our time has come? How do we know that we can go on for the glory of God? And how do I know when my time is where I'm not going to feel like a victim and I'm not going to feel like I'm wrong and I'm not going to feel like I'm in a place where I'm all alone? When is my time going to come? I don't know when your time will come, but I will say this, there's a purpose for it. There's a purpose for it. And there's a reason why you go through what you go through, and there's a purpose of why you face what you face. And at the end of the day, what you don't understand but you must accept and identify with is the waiting game is a time for spiritual growth. Because it will pull out of you the very thing that nobody sees. It will pull out of you the insecurities of a divorced mom and dad, of something that happened bad in your childhood. It'll pull out something of a complex where people told you you would never be nothing. You would never add up to nothing. It'll pull out something of hatred and anger and wrong that settles down in your soul that nobody sees it because of the mask that is on the outside, and we find ourselves in a place that we think, when will my time come? And we wonder, how do I overcome it? Quickly tonight, as I give you an outline, let me say it this way. The way you overcome and you do not see yourself as a victim, you listen to me, is you look at the right things, you look at the right way, and you have the right perspective. When you lose the perspective that you should have, you will have this victim mentality. Now, let me say this. It's an independent Baptist church, and man, we want to hear preaching and grace and salvation and all these things, and we want to know how to be separated, sanctified, set apart. I mean, we want to know all of this, and we want to know how we can be forgiven and be able to come back to the Lord Jesus Christ, and we want to know how we can chase dreams and do all these things. Hey, but let me say this to you. There's a lot of good Christians tonight. They're not serving the Lord anymore. They're not walking with God anymore. They're not singing for God anymore. They're not serving God anymore. They're not coming to church anymore. They're not fellowshipping anymore. They're not praying anymore. They're not shouting anymore. They're not praising no more. They're not worshiping no more. Hey, the reason why is not because God has dried them up. It's because they got the wrong perspective. And they thought that they were a victim, and they think, why me? I don't deserve this. Why must this happen? Three things tonight that I want you to see. If you're looking at text, turn over to Genesis chapter number 39. Number one, the secret to success spiritually And the secret to have the right perspective is to refuse to remove some things in your life. Notice, if you will, follow along. The Bible says in verse number 2 of chapter number 39, and the Lord was with Joseph. Look at verse number 3. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all that he did to prosper in his hand. Verse number 5. And it came to pass from the time that he had made him overseer of his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian house. Notice verse number 21, if you will. The Bible says, but the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy. Notice verse number 23, if you will. The keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him, and that which he did, the Lord made it prosper. Turn over to chapter number 41, if you will. The Bible says in verse number 16, and Joseph answered Pharaoh, saying, it is not in me. He said, God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. Notice verse number 28, if you will. The Bible says, this is the thing which I have spoken unto Pharaoh. What God is about to do, he showeth unto Pharaoh. Verse number 32, and for that the dream was doubled unto Pharaoh twice, it is because a thing is established by God, and God will surely bring it to pass. What are you saying, Brother Jason? Hey, the secret to overcoming the faults and the problems and the pain and being a victim is to remember never to remove God from the equation, and know everything that you face, that God is always in the middle of it.
Right. Yes, sir.
And the problem tonight is we have allowed the situations of our life be bigger than the God that we serve. We have allowed the difficulties that come against us to be bigger than the God that we serve. We have allowed the inadequacies and the insecurities that we have become to be bigger than God. And now we got a lot of wounded, self-pity Christians thinking that God is done with them, God's not doing anything, all simply because you've got the wrong perspective. Are you a victim tonight from something? The most independent Baptists said, no, I'm not that careless. I'm not that emotional. I'm not somebody that gets easily offended, really. Now, how come some things have changed? How come your worship has changed and your praise has changed and your service has changed? How come your zeal has changed? You say, well, Brother Jason, it's just because you know how it is. You get saved by the grace of God. You get knocked down a couple of times. The wind just gets knocked out of you, and it gets tough and it gets hard, and it's just human nature. Yes, it is human nature. But the Bible says that you're to walk after the Spirit and not after flesh. And when you get to a place that you realize that God is in the smack dab middle of everything that you face, you can change your mind. You can change your perspective. You could go on for the glory of God and realize that everything that goes on, that God stays in control of everything you face. But we're quitting, we're turning around, and we're stopping simply because we've removed God from the equation. When Joseph was in the pit, God was with him. When Joseph was a slave, God was with him. When Joseph was in Potiphar's house and falsely accused, God was with him. When he was in the jail, in the prison, God was with him. He came to a place to where he knows, hey, that God knew everything about his circumstances. He knew that God would be wherever he went. He knew that God understood everything that was done. Hey, he understood that if anything was going to be done and evil come against him, hey, that God had it permitted. Why do you know that, Brother Jason? Because the Bible says, hey, that the children of God cannot be touched until it goes through the hands of God and to the approval of God. And if God don't permit it, it's never going to happen. God is in the middle of everything you're facing. You said, my marriage is struggling. God's in the middle of it. He's trying to stir the pot so you get things right. You say, but I'm in a situation where I ain't got the zeal I has to, and there's problems that come against me. Because God's trying to bring up out of you insecurities and faults and failures that's been in your life for a long time. And until you realize that God's in the middle of your circumstances to get you out of you, you're never going to get away from being a victim.
Amen.
You're never going to get away from it. And here he comes to this place, and he realizes that I have been robbed. You listen to me. I have been robbed of everything, is what Joseph said. Listen to me, teenagers, mom and dad, servants, Christians, people of God. I mean, to a place to where literally you are robbed of everything. But the one thing that was never taken away was the purpose that God had. They took away his testimony. They took away his coat. They took away his family. They separated from people he loved. They took away the very thing that he stood for. They took away his voice. They took away his authority. They took away his boldness. They took away a lot of things. But the one thing they never took away was the purpose that God had for his life. He made his mind up. I'm going to serve God, and I'm going to seek out it. I'm not going to let my perspective change. I'm going to let my eyes stay on the Lord. I'll say this as a transition to my next point. A lot of you might not understand it until you allow it to sink in. But if you really take God as seriously as you say you do, and you're as close to God as you think that you are, and you're living the life that you think that you should, and you're so sold out, know your Bible, and you are doctrinally correct on everything, you listen to me. You might fall because of the flesh, but you'll come to a place to where you'll never be a victim. Because if you walk close enough to God, even when the trials of life come, you say, I'm not a victim. God's allowing this to happen. A victim is somebody that is wrong, that's cheated, that's pushed away. Somebody that's been done because of an event that is harmful. I mean, a victim is something that's wrong. And listen, when you walk close to God like Joseph, you say, hey, I know, victim. You might be wanting to do something bad. And you might meant for evil. And you might have different objectives. And yes, you might be getting me destroyed and to walk away. He said, but I'm walking with Jesus. And I know I'm in the center of his will. I'm not no victim. I'm a victor because I know that God is on my side. Be careful, because the true identity and the true temperature of your relationship will be revealed in the way that you explain and the explanation of how you've become a victim. Yes, sir. Leads me to my second point. To have the right perspective, you must refuse to remove some things, being God. And number two, you must be resolved on the actual reason. Well, Brother Jason, you just talked about that. God has a purpose. No, you don't understand what I'm saying. Wednesday night, I begin to introduce this thought as I begin to preach about overcoming all the emotionalism and things that's in our life. And you come to this place. Notice the text. If you go over to Genesis chapter number 50, verse number 20. Key verse, key word, you'll see right in here. Notice as he says, verse 20. But as for you, listen to the text. Ye thought evil against me. Evil against me. There's a resolve to the reason. In other words, his mind was made up of what the real problem is. Let me say it this way. When you get distracted and you begin to think that everything that you're facing is what the problem is and all this emotion's going on, hey, let me say something. You will become to be emotional. Hey, you will be affected. Hey, you will be angry. You will be mad. You will be bitter. You will be jealous. You'll be overwhelmed. You'll be disheartened. You'll be discouraged. Somebody say amen. You're going to find yourself to a place to where you don't know what to do. You don't know what to do. Because you're not resolved on the reason of your circumstances. The Bible says here that it was evil. As you begin to read these things, and he begins to speak this, starting in verse number 19, when he says, and Joseph said to them, fear not, for I am, listen, for am I in the place of God, but as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it to good, to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. Look at me, hey, this is a confident man. Joseph is speaking now because he's made his mind up. He says, man, I've been through some things. I'm not a victim. I'm not somebody that you got to have pity on. I'm not in that place. Listen, we got a lot of independent Baptists, sold out, saved, sanctified, set apart people, hey, that have got so much in a coward perspective anymore. Hey, we want to quit and we want people to look at us and we're walking around kicking the rocks and thinking, oh, me and oh, my, I just can't do it. And the truth be told, it's because you're not close to God and you're so much worried about the emotionalism in your life. How it makes you feel. You got the right to feel that way. And the whole truth is because you don't realize the devil's got you so distracted by thinking emotionally that you can't even see the reason for the sin that's in life. And instead of addressing the problem, we're addressing emotion. I'm just angry. I'm just mad. And what happens is our emotions, we find out, is rooted by evil actions. And we all know, as we taught and preached on Wednesday night, that emotions is caused by one thing. And everybody say it with me, sin. Everybody say it with me, sin. And listen, one of the greatest things I've learned in my life, other than the thought of salvation through Jesus Christ, repentance, confession, is to come to a place in my life to be able to realize that the very things that I'm facing and the emotion that I feel and the monster inside of me that is coming out, is the very thing that I ought to flee from because it's caused by a sin that was committed against me or by me in my life. See, the problem is we can't fix our anger. We can't fix our wrath. We can't fix our bitterness. We can't fix that. We can't ever fix anything simply because we're addressing the emotion that's in our life. And if you would take time to identify the sin that was committed against you and by you, you would fix your problem. I've said this many times. I'll say it again. Cut off the apples off the apple tree all you want. As long as there's still roots down, it's still going to be an apple tree.
Right.
You say, Brother Jason, you trying to tell me to overcome my anger and my bitterness and all the things that I'm facing tonight that it's not emotion, that it's sin? Absolutely. Absolutely. You don't believe me? Turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter number 2. I did it the other night. I'm not going to go to it. Genesis chapter number 2, verse number 25. If you take notes, write it down. The Bible says that Adam and Eve was naked and not ashamed. Genesis chapter number 3, verse number 7, the Bible says that Adam and Eve was naked and they were ashamed. They clothed themselves. The Bible says, if you continue to read down to chapter number 3, that then there was anger that set in. See, emotions never existed until sin came into the garden. And what we don't realize is it's not the emotion. The emotion is the aftermath of the sin that's been committed. And when you'll learn to forgive the sin and the wrong that's been committed, or maybe the wrong that you've done to somebody else, when you can overcome, because see, a lot of times your anger and your frustration is not a sin that's coming against you. It might be the shame of the sin that you committed against somebody else. Come on, somebody say amen. You know how heartbreaking it is to know that you've hurt somebody, defeated somebody, ruined somebody to a place to where now they don't sing, teach, serve. They don't have joy no more. Do you know the ripping of the soul? And the emotion says there's guilt because you've never forgiven yourself from the sin that was committed. Biblically speaking, the emotions is due to sin somewhere. Fear, anger, bitterness, abandonment. What is your emotion? Now, let me ask you the question. What sin caused it? Listen to me. Let's go back to Joseph. Everybody with me say amen. I'm trying to help you. Can you imagine Joseph in that place? Now he's standing up a confident man. He said, "For what you meant for evil, hey, God meant for it to be good." He says, "The place that I'm in is the place that I should be. I know I'm in the center of God's will." He was confident. He was sure. He was bold. He had authority. Why? Because he never allowed the emotion to derail him, because he knew that it was sin that was the root of what happened. And see, when you address sin, there's a biblical principle to address the sin and remove the sin. Somebody say amen. You can't change anger. You can't say, "I'll remove the anger." No, no, God says, well, when you remove that sin and you'll forgive, I'll remove the anger. Come on now, help me preach on, preach on. I'm preaching to myself. I'm preaching to myself. So what is it that's there? You say, "Brother Jason, I don't know. There's a lot of things. Am I bitter? Am I mad? Am I angry?" I want you to listen to this tonight. I read this off. I'm trying to hurry. How do you know people are bitter? How would you know that Joseph was bitter? Teenagers, you listen to me. Separation of mom and dad, abandonment by somebody that you love, a friend that's talked about you, maybe a leader in a church that has hurt you, or somebody in the church that's down you or talking about you, maybe a church member tonight. Hey, you're wanting to know, am I bitter? I mean, somebody's done me wrong. It's been a husband, a wife, a spouse of some sort. It's been a family member. It's been a son or a daughter, a mom or a dad. It's been somebody that's been a preacher or a teacher. I mean, am I really bitter? Hey, you've seen your saints for so long. You're living a life and you want to know, why is the devil creeping up on me? Am I really bitter? Am I really bitter? Am I upset? Listen to what it says. People are bitter, number one, they desire to make somebody else suffer. This person desires to make somebody else suffer because they might somehow allow their inner hurt and anger out by saying and doing things to hurt the feelings of others. And somehow it makes that bitter individual feel better to see somebody else hurt. Number one sign that you might be bitter. Number two, they are full of vindictiveness. What do you mean by that, Brother Jason? In other words, they are doing their very best to get back at those that have either neglected them, mistreated them, disrespected them, or even at times ignores them. Listen to me. Listen to me. He comes to the next place and he says it this way. He says, they are full of vindictiveness. Number three, they wade in self-pity. In other words, they often feel cheated or shortchanged in your life. Those people that talk like that a lot are bitter.
Yeah, right.
You're bitter.
Right.
As he continues to be able to go down to these people of self-pity, he says this, it's almost impossible for such a person to experience genuine gratitude and thankfulness. When's the last time you really rejoiced in your heart? He says, because if so, that person that's in self-bitter, it's because somehow they feel that they've been denied their due. They often feel sorry for themselves, and it's very hard for anyone else to feel compassion for them.
Right.
They're bitter.
Amen.
They're bitter. Number four, they're looking for a fight. They will almost come to a place to where they will provoke something to allow the emotion on the inside to come out. Because they're bitter.
Amen.
Teenagers, you know how mom and dad and preachers and stuff know that you're bitter, and by the way, it's because of something that's done wrong. Don't be ashamed of that. Because something happens, you begin to flare up and you get mad, jealous about another brother or sister. You are provoking a frustration in your life and in your home because you're bitter of something that's happened. Amen. That is a bitter person.
Amen.
The next thing is, they have psychopathic pride. In other words, the world has done them wrong and deserves to be full expression and take responsibility of their blame. Number six, they are drowning in resentment. A bitter person, it's hard to find, experience happiness and success due to the well-being of other people. Instead, they get to a place to where they view a person's good fortune as somebody else, the evidence that they have not been given a fair chance and it's been given to them. Critical of somebody's success. Number seven, they are narcissists. The bitter soul simply cannot go beyond the immediate wants. And it's all about them. And they are inherently emotionally needed. Let me ask you a question tonight. You might not be bitter, but you might be angry. You might be hurt. You might be in a place where you're just like Joseph and you say, I don't know if that's really me. Listen, you might not have been through those things, but you're finding yourself now that there is a reason to address the problems that's going on in your life. And man, you're fearful. You're overwhelmed. You're now in the top spin. Everybody got it together but you. And you're suffering and crying out and you're wondering, why can't I make it? If Joseph can get out of the pit, if Joseph can get out of prison, if Joseph can get out of Potiphar's house, if he can rise back to the occasion, and God do something for him, why can't I get a deliverance from what I'm facing? Because you're emotional. And when you address the sin, you will alienate the emotion that's in your life. Listen to me, humbly say this. You have to address the wrong that's been done in your life. You have to. Quickly standing, stop with me. Mr. Avery, go ahead and come to the piano, if you will. Y'all sing some. I want you to think about this for just a moment. I wrote this down. Think about Moses. Abandoned, pretty much pushed aside, exiled from the people that was his own people. 40 years he stayed in the desert. Do you know what it probably did from him emotionally? If all he did was dealt with things emotionally, do you ever think he would have got out? I'm not done preaching. Y'all stay with me. There's more here. Think about David. Sought after to kill the very man that he held his own arms up. The Bible says that he killed thousands. David killed tens of thousands. And this man literally had to hide in caves. And he was stripped of everything that he had. A best friend, the love of his life. He had absolutely nothing. And he was so overwhelmed. Can you imagine the state of mind that he was in? If he lived emotionally, do you ever think he would have ever came out of that? He had to come to a place to think, I'm not a victim. I'm not a victim. I'm not a victim. God has meant for this to be good, even though evil has come against me.
Right.
Think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Y'all been the goat? Amen. I wish I had a goat. Somebody say amen. I had one. My wife made me get rid of it. Somebody say, oh, me. Yeah, I was a man until that happened. And I had a garden. A deer ate it. Couldn't even take care of that. So I had a goat. Had a tire tied to its neck. And I thought, bless God, there might be a bunch of country men in here, but ain't nobody got a goat with a tire tied to it. She took that away from me, too. Somebody say amen. I'm bitter. Them stupid dogs and animals she wants, bless God, I don't want none of it. Think about Paul. Play for me, Deborah. Miss Deborah. Think about Paul. Acts 27, Euroclodon hits. Separated him from people that he loved traveling the journey with, to find himself losing security and confidence, and ended up on shore with just pieces. Looking around, thinking, where's everybody at? Sure, he could have been a victim. And he could have asked God why. But he knew in his heart, God's in control. Matter of fact, the Bible says he got up and he went and ministered to people when he hit that shore. You know how you know you're over bitterness? When you get back to ministering to people. In close, I want to say this and I'll be done. How to have the right perspective. How not to be a victim. Number one, you refuse to remove God. Number two, you have a resolve of what the reason is. It's not the emotion, though it's real. And listen, the real emotion, you can't deny it. And it's okay. That's not an issue. But I'm trying to help you tonight. You need to address the sin that's been in your life. The last thing, and I'm done, to have the right perspective, you must refuse to rationalize what's going on. I don't have time to go through this, but in the same verse, chapter number 50, the Bible says, notice in verse number 20, he says, but as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good, to bring it pass as it to this day, to save much people alive. He comes to a place here to where a lot of people think, well, the devil's got me exactly where he wants me. When you begin to rationalize what you're going through, you listen to me, you will begin to think the devil has got me right where he wants me. I got news for you. If the devil's got you right where he wants you, God's got you right where he wants you to. If the devil's got you where he wants you, then God's got you right where he wants you. You got to get the right perspective. You've got to get it to the place to understand what you meant for evil, God meant it to be good. Notice, if you will, the order in the text, verse number 20. Ye thought evil, but God, and then notice, unto good. Look at me. Here's the equation. Your evil plus God always equals good. Your evil plus God always equals good. I don't have time to go through Joseph's life. He got to a place where a nation was literally birthed out because of his brothers coming back into Egypt. And all of that was done. Why? Because it started off with a young man that lost his very identity and what mattered. Listen, it was taken away from him. The very thing that gave him confidence, the very thing that made him hold his head high, the very thing that picked him up when nothing else was around and he was proud of, that very thing that was taken, it was turned and put him into a pit a pit put him into being sold. Sold and it put him into slavery. Slavery put him into Potiphar's house. Potiphar's house put him in front of Potiphar's wife. Potiphar's wife put him in a place of being falsely accused. That put him over into the prison. Hey, the prison put him into a place of a butler and also a cupbearer, of forgetting about the dream. But the dream then turned out to be a dream of Pharaoh. The dream of Pharaoh turned out to be somebody to be second in command. All of these things that turned out to seem to be evil, when you added God, it came out to be good. And here this very, very individual, it could have been a victim, it should have been a victim. Listen to me. You got two, I want you to stay with me. Please stay with me. You got two choices. You have the right to feel the way you feel. And I'm telling you, you do. You got the right. If you're hurt, betrayed, scared, abandoned, you have the right to feel that way. You do. I'm not saying it. But I'm not asking about our rights and our wrongs. I'm not asking about our pain. I'm asking about God's purpose. What matters most to you? Just like you too are going to have to make up your mind. The purpose of God is greater than the pain that I feel. And I'm going to get over these emotions because I'm going to address the sin. And I think in my heart, and I'm convinced with this, we need to get back to where we forgive, we let go, and we understand even the things that come against us, the government, society, everything. They might mean it for evil, but God means it to be good. It's spiritual growth, it's personal growth, and until you ever identify that it's bringing what's inside of you that is not pure to the outside of you, you ain't never going to fix it. But when people begin to see what's so negative and what's so nasty on the inside, then we have shame. We want to do something about it because it affects us. And God says, listen, I can't use you until I fix that. And God will do whatever it takes to get it out. Invitation tonight is this. Are you going to make your mind up to address the sin and alienate, if you will, the emotion? You're going to come to a place to where you realize that I can be a victim, or I can just realize that God's got a plan. Accept what God's doing and move on for His marvelous grace. Stay in your feet.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. But the great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth Him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, that the world through Him might be saved. That means that God sent His Son to die for those of us who are sinners, so that we can have fellowship with God Himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that He tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? I want to ask you, would you trust in Him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from, God sent His Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept Him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.